Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Nate Preisinger. I am privileged to serve as one of the pastors here at Bethany Lutheran Church, and I will be leading this memorial service for Helene Pande, a woman who I've gotten to know a little bit over the last week through stories from friends and family. A wonderful, energetic woman with so much to share and so much to celebrate here today. We are gathered to remember and celebrate her life, but most importantly, we are gathered here today to celebrate the promises of Christ's resurrection. Promises that Helene now knows personally. On behalf of the family, thank you all for coming out and making this a part of your day today. Just a couple of housekeeping items before we begin. Hopefully you all received a copy of the program on your way in and had a chance to sign the guest book. If not, that is in the right outside the entrance, directly in front of me. Also, should you require restrooms, those are out this door and to your left. And please do plan on staying afterwards for a reception, which will be held in our social hall, which is diagonal from me right here, out into your right, my left, as you exit. I believe those are all the pieces. Oh, one more thing I should mention. We will be singing several hymns as part of this memorial service. Those can be found in the red hymnals in the pew backs in front of you. Those are the larger books. The smaller red books are the Bible. You can read that too. But the hymnals are the larger red books. And please do join us when it is time to sing there. Very good. We open with a word of prayer. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation, who comforts us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrow with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. Friends, when we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death, and we were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with Christ in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. I now invite you to stand and join us in singing our opening hymn. It's number 660 in the back of those red hymnals, Lift High the Cross.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our sister Helene. We thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, O Lord, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may live in confidence and hope until by your call we are gathered to our heavenly home in the company of all your saints. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, we pray. Amen. You may be seated for the readings.
Please join me in reading Psalm 23. It is
a Graham. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
I can see clearly. See all obstacles in my way. Gone are the dark clouds that had me down. It's gonna be a bright, bright, sunshiny day. It's gonna be a bright, bright, sunshiny day. Yes, I can make it now, the rain is gone. All of the bad feelings have disappeared. Here is that rainbow I've been praying for. It's gonna be a bright, 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 sunshiny day. All around, there's nothing but blue sky. Look straight ahead, there's nothing but blue sky. Ooh. I can see clearly. See all obstacles in my way. Here is the rainbow I've been praying for. It's gonna be a bright, 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 sunshiny day. It's gonna be a bright, 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 sunshiny day. It's gonna be a bright, 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 sunshiny day. It's gonna be a bright, bright, sunshiny day.
That was one of my mom's favorite songs. I'm Helena, one of mom's daughters, one of her twin daughters. My mom was always a happy person, and nothing was more important to her than to let people know that she loved them and she cared about them. She always put her family first, but right up there was everyone else. She loved people. She lived a life of spreading her joy and positivity. She lived a life spreading her joy and positivity and caring and giving to others. Mom was the eternal optimist and saw the good in everyone and everything. When times are challenging, you would still see a smile on her face and hear the laughter in her voice. She never let anything get her down. I don't think I ever saw my mom in a bad mood. My mom went through her entire life with love in her heart, a lighthearted sense of humor, with grace and gratitude. When we were growing up, Mom was always the fun mom. The opposite of strict, we had very little rules. We always had fun toys and games to play with, lots of arts and crafts. We had silly putty and Play-Doh and paints and baking projects with permanent food coloring that the other moms would never allow. She never got mad if we tracked snow in the house or we washed our muddy hands in the sink after making mud pies in the woods. If we spilled something, she would always say, "That was an accident," and she could never get mad at an accident. She also said that she loved all of God's creatures, and we had many. Bunnies, hamsters, guinea pigs, gerbils, fish, chickens, snakes, a poodle, a dove, a stray cat, lizards, and even a pet alligator. Did I miss any? Mom never held back any affection, as she would give us love bites and kisses and call us her little lambs, and always told us, she'd call us her little lambs and always told us how much she loved us. And how beautiful we were. This is true. Even when Barbara and I were in middle school and we were chubby with ugly hair perms and pimples and not even remotely attractive, my mom would tell us that we were so beautiful. She was never one to criticize or judge us, not ever. Mom also treated our friends and our relatives this way, as if they were her very own. She would tell them she was their runaway mother, and if they ever needed a place to run to or a shoulder to cry on, she would be there for them. In fact, recently, we have heard from so many people how my mother helped them through hard times, and without my mom, they wouldn't have had anywhere to go or wouldn't be where they are today. She was a second mom to many, and our friends always felt welcome and loved. Her love for all really was unconditional. Giving was one of my mom's favorite things. I remember so many times she would invite people to our home for Thanksgiving if they had nowhere to go, often people that she hardly even knew. "There's always room at the inn," she would say. Often Mom would take money out of her purse and give it to a stranger, even when times were tight. When I had morning sickness with Christine, my mom read that ginger helps. At the end of her workday, she dropped by a huge gift basket that had ginger tea, ginger candy, etc. She filled the entire basket with every single ginger product she could find. In the nursing home, she wanted Barbara and I to bring in some dog treats so she could give a treat to the service animals. If you said you'd like something of hers, she would say, "Here, take it, you can have it," and she'd literally just give it to you. When my kids were little, she told them she was the Nana Fairy. Every time they slept over, she would make them yummy foods and have a craft project for them to work on. And at night, she became the fairy and put little gifts under their pillows. A couple weeks before Nana passed, Anna was visiting, and Mom told Anna to go into her drawer and pick out a pretty necklace to take home. Mom just loved to give. Mom was also very accomplished at many things. Everything she did it well. She ran her own business, SNAP Staffing Services, for over 20 years. She was a gourmet cook who rarely followed a recipe. She was a competitive bridge player. She loved politics and current events and loved to debate and was also a voracious reader of nonfiction. Mom also loved holidays and entertaining. She loved going to a party. My father told me once that people invited Mom to their business dinners and parties because she would always make people feel welcome and she always livened up the room. The life of the party, as my dad would say. If there was a shy person or someone being left out, Mom was right there, making that person feel special. It was just natural to her. Mom was a great conversationalist, always being the one to ask the questions and being the listener. She was never one to talk about herself. She was more interested in learning about you, and then maybe out of that conversation, she would find some way to give to you or to help you. Some fun facts of my mom before I close is Helene loved desserts, especially chocolate, and she wasn't shy to ask for the corner piece with the big frosting rose. She loved sour gummy worms. She was very fashionable and always dressed nicely. She loved cashmere and didn't like to leave the house without her red lipstick on. She loved celebrating holidays and birthdays and focused on the extra details to make them extra special. She never cut a corner. She loved vodka on the rocks or martinis. And we're gonna have some later to celebrate her life. But we would have to tell the kids when they're little to be careful not to drink Nana's water. She was never jealous. She was always her authentic self. Mom loved to mentor young professionals in business and write resumes for them. She even offered to write a resume for one of her caregivers who at the nursing home, pro bono, of course, she said. She secretly gave our dog Tank food under the dinner table, even when I'd tell her, no, Mom. And she also would make and buy special little mini bagels for our dog, Max. She always loved a naughty joke, not too naughty, but a little naughty was okay. She never complained, not ever, even living with her chronic pain. She would always forgive very quickly. She loved to shop and buy gifts. She never disliked anyone or ever held a grudge, even if someone wronged her or was unkind. Her meals were always gourmet, but somehow she always burned the dinner rolls. Halfway through many dinners, she'd yell, Henry, the rolls, and they'd be black. She never allowed the ketchup bottle or any other bottles on the table, and we only used cloth napkins. By the way, I've probably ironed at least 10,000 napkins in my life. We always had family dinners together after my parents' cocktail hour. Many times, us kids were starving to death and yelling for our food, but we would have to wait for us all to be together, even if it was 8 o'clock. We'd tell her that our friends all got to eat at 5, but she didn't care. Eating together was important to her. She loved perfume and flowers. My dad spoiled her with these things throughout her life. She loved geography and always had a globe near her chair. She never would give up. She always had tenacity, faith, and strength. She was always running a little late. We started giving her a fake time, but then she caught on and would ask us what the real time, if it was the real time or the fake time. Then we all got mixed up and we had no idea what time we were all getting together. She never told a lie or even fudged a little. She was honest as they come. She always told us that family sticks together no matter what. She always said that family sticks together no matter what, and it's important that we always love each other. Pandas stick together, she would say. In closing, I hope you've learned something new about my mom, or feel like you knew her. Mom loved her family more than anything, and she told us often near the end how much she had for us, and how grateful she was for her beautiful family and her amazing life. Her greatest gift to me was to show me how you live your life with a loving heart and not take life too seriously, just have fun. She is now in heaven with Henry, the love of her life, and that makes me so happy they're together again. Thank you. I'm Twin B, Barbara, and that was beautiful, Helena. You're going to hear a lot of the same things because she just was that kind of person. Our mom was always upbeat, positive, and caring. The ultimate hostess with the mostest. That was her saying. Or, good things always happen for the Pandas. That was also something she would say. One passion she had was singing. Though we were kind of mean, we never let her sing. But she did have her favorite Christmas tune, Winter Wonderland. The only tune that my husband can really remember her not only singing, but doing a little something with her hands. So she would go, da da da, da 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 da. So my mom was very, vibrant, you know, so you will hear it in the postlude. So it's not Christmas, but just one of her favorite tunes. Another gesture she had was when she would celebrate by saying, yay, when things went well. And again, I guess I'm gonna show you her physical appearance when she was happy, because she would always go, yay, yay, you know, and yay. So she embraced it, let me tell you. May sound a bit corny, but this was our mom. She was full of life, very vibrant and expressive in everything she did, always authentic. In elementary school, back in New Jersey, being sick was always a great day. When we were homesick, Mom would give us her bedroom so we could watch the only TV in the house. Well, we did have one in the basement, but nobody wanted to go down there. She would bring home some sort of toy or doll to play with, you know, when she'd come home for lunch and check up on us and that sort of thing, or coloring books and new crayons. My favorite toy was a doll. Name Natalie. Obviously, I love that name because that's my daughter's name. But that brings up my memory when we were kids. Food was served to us on a tray with cloth napkin. If we were just needing a well day, Mom said, every now and then you need a Mamie day. If I was having a bad day at school, she taught me that it was okay to cry,
but to try to gather up your courage at school and come home, and that she would be there to cry on her shoulder. I remember this, and I think it was good wisdom, and she had wisdom at all levels of life. She gave us what we needed, but was firm too. We realized from a young age to respect her, that we were going to learn many great things from our mom. Bedtime with mom was always lots of hugs, snuggles, and funny faces and duck sound effects. She had, I guess I'm just gonna do all the body language today, but she would go, what was it like? What did she do, Helena? You know? And then, yeah, I can't even do it, my little chubby cheeks. And she'd always go, tucky, 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 which I carried on to my children. We'd always tucky, tucky, tucky. Mine were probably a little more violent than mom's, but. She knew the value of taking care of us as well as herself. We four kids, with four kids, she needed help. And I used to think, oh, that's kind of, as a young adult before children, I used to think, well, that was kind of weak and selfish that you'd have help. My gosh, what's wrong with you, lady? And now after being a mother with two children, not four, I realized it was so that she would be readily available to us for more important things. Family dinners, trips to the library, family outings on the weekends. That was what was important to her, family. Cleaning house was not her thing. We had summer vacations and outings at Lake Girard, Deer Lake, Cape Cod, trips to Norway to get to know our Norwegian family, Europe, and Vail to learn to ski. And when we grew up and left the nest, mom and dad always took long weekends, cruises, and trips abroad. They really had a wonderful relationship. A little bit about mom and her start in her career. Way back before meeting my father, she went to Toby Colburn School for Fashion Career in New York City. She later was the highest salesperson for the, I think it was Foley's, we can't quite agree on the name of the store at the time, in both bridal and lingerie. That was big for women back then, especially for the times. She was a great go-getter. Mom and Dad met on an arranged blind date by our grandfather. He had taken a real liking to this new Norwegian engineer working for him. Thought it would be great for the two to meet. It was a great decision. And as Helena said, my mother owned Snap Staffing Services. First, she started it in New Jersey, and then when we moved to Colorado, she then started up later with my father and continued for another 20 years. She was always a visionary, and boy, did she have the gift of conversation. Excellent salesperson. I was gonna say the gift of gab and a mouthpiece, but then I took it out, but I'm gonna give it back. I had the privilege of working with them for 13 years, and yes, I did say 13 years, part-time and then full-time, until Natalie was born. I enjoyed those days. The best part of mom and dad is that they had an amazing relationship. Their lives have rubbed off on me in a big way. I know what is important in a marriage. I know what's important with work ethic and what's important for family. Through them, they were the best witness. Every day of their marriage, they put an hour or so aside for them to talk about the day and drink a nice martini. Mom's ideal martini is vodka, 3 drops of vermouth, not 4, 5, or 6, but 3, and either a twist of lemon or 3 onions. Olives were always okay too. We'd starve waiting for dinner as kids. But in retrospect, what they did was teach us the value of taking time together. Toasting each other, eyes fixated on each other until the first sip. Again, kind of corny, but really, what a lesson in love they showed to each of us. Dinners were always gourmet, so you're hearing a common thread here tonight, or today. Our mother loved to cook. She'd set the dining room table with cloth napkins, water and wine glasses, full silverware service, whether it was needed or not. She enjoyed making the table nice, always candles burning. That's when I learned that my brother Chris was a bit of a pyromaniac. Just kidding. But I do remember he had always liked to put the candles out with his fingers. Anyway, Christmas time was her favorite holiday. She would go overboard every year. We spent hours opening our gifts. Sorry to say that, but it was true. She loved to give, made sure we all had enough to open. Mom was mom to many. She always opened her arms to anyone who needed it. She was a giver in so many ways. Childhood friends reminisced what a wonderful second mother she was to them during times of difficulty in their lives. A great tribute to our mom. She loved us all, asked us how we were doing always, and showed interest in each of our lives, sons, daughters, grandchildren alike. Her final words, don't worry, I have makeup in my purse. I can fix this up later. Her final words told to Anna, her granddaughter, "I'm not going to be sad. That's just not me." That was probably when she was a little more lucid. And then it went on to me as we left her one afternoon. And to me, this was her worst, or I mean, her last time I heard her voice. She said with a soft voice, "Catch you later." And to Helena, somewhere within that realm of time, "There's so much love." She is with Dad now, 7 months waiting for her, and just moments in heaven's time. I can see him say, "Helene, I've missed you. You finally made it." He was a Swiss clock, and Mom was always fashionably late. Thank you.
This is the second time in 7 months I've been up here, a little bit too soon, but much of that has been said is in what I was going to talk about, but I can add to it. And sometimes it's good to tell stories. People remember stories. All that my wonderful sister said is 100% true. So I'll improvise a little bit. I would say the top three attributes of my mother were positive, positive, positive. She was always a positive person, and that instilled a positivity in myself, and I think with my children and my wife, and she radiated that positiveness to everyone. I see some people going yes, and that is almost where they say 90% is showing up. I don't know if that's quite that fraction, but that positiveness just radiated. Dinners. It was so important that we had dinners, and she said we'll not always be together to have a family dinner. And yes, we had cloth napkins and we had candles every night, and it was always a special thing. And my mother truly was a gourmet cook. You know, when you go to a really high-end restaurant and you have a salad or something, you go, "Wow, this is really good." We had that pretty much every night. Maybe past 8 p.m., but there was always that, you know, that period of they would have their drinks, and then we sometimes, or many times, would have an assortment of cheeses that my father would have, Norwegian and Swiss and Gruyere and all these wonderful cheeses, And then one day my mother presented a can of cheese, one of those fake cheeses. And my father was just, he was just every fiber of his body, "Oh, Helene, how can you have that fake cheese?" You know, he says, "No, look, I don't have to cut it. I can just put it on the cracker and eat it. It's so much more convenient." But anyway, that was the interaction then. The one thing, I'll tell another quick story. She was always experimenting with food. And one of them, we had this, she'd make this standard beautiful salad. And one time she made this Caesar salad. I think my sisters remember. And they're eating the salad, you know, the salad. And then all of a sudden, Helene's like, "Bleh, bleh, bleh, bleh." My mother's like, "What, what?" And she goes, "Barbara, spit up in the salad." Anyway, it was the eggs. She used raw eggs in the salad because it was a true Caesar salad. I don't know if that went well, but okay. we'll move on to that. We'll move on to that. Some of our fondest memories, all of us, was we belonged to this place called the Deer Lake Club, and it was this fairly large lake, and it had around it had picnic benches, and it had a club, and we had a sailboat there. We'd go with the sailboat and go sailing, and it had a lake front with a beach and a slide. It was a wonderful place. But on certain Saturdays in the summer, we would go there, and my mother would prepare this enormous meal, and we'd find that she had her favorite picnic bench, and it was right by the water, and it had the dogwoods, the crimson, and in the spring, the crimson and the pink dogwoods. And then we'd go there on this big picnic bench, and it was always, my father had to go early to get it because she wanted that one, you know, for the family. So he'd go, you know, "Helene, I'm going there at 7 a.m, you know, nobody's there." Well, but then we'll have that picnic bench. And then we'd have this beautiful meal on this beautiful picnic bench, and my father would make the steaks, and it was just, you know, that's my fondest memories of my mother. Okay, there is an area here we didn't talk about, and that is politics. My mother had these kind of crazy ideas, and one of them was a crazy idea that my grandfather had. It was just crazy. This is when I'm a little kid, and my grandfather said this, and my mother, she said, "There's this country in the world that's this backward country, but one day it will rival America." It's just a crazy idea. It will be an economic and a political and a militaristic competitor to us, and it will be superior to us. And we're like, "You gotta be kidding." And that was China. And another story on politics. I'll tell the story, but she was, yeah, I can see my sister's cringing. So in grammar school in Essex Fells, there was a trip to the United Nations, and we're all excited. So we get on the bus with all the kids, and we go to the United Nations, and we go into the, you know, into the great halls, and then we're walking by, and there's this huge carpet on the wall, and it says this carpet has millions of stitches, and only 5 of them or something, you can fact check me, are made imperfectively, because that's like humans. This huge carpet is perfect, but these 5 stitches are purposely they're not perfect because humans aren't. And I was telling my mother that, and she says, "Well, do you have like a trip report you have to do?" And I go, "Well, yeah, yeah." She says, "Well, let me help you write it." So saying more or less that the title of my trip report, this is grammar school, was "Defects in the United Nations." I'm not making this up. So I'm a little, you know, like the transcriber of this whole thing. It seems a little high level for me. And our teacher, she was like, Mrs. Hall, I think it was, she was like pro United Nations. So I sent it in. I got it back. I got a C-. At least I didn't get, you know, brought to the principal for plagiarism, but or whatever. But my mother wrote it. But one more on that line, you know, Halloween is a really wonderful time for children. It really is. And we would go around, but then the United Nations had this thing called UNICEF, where you had these little boxes and you'd collect pennies and dimes, and that money would go to poor people in the world. Well, my mother had read through the John Bircher Society that money was buying guns for rebels. So every time I'd go with my little box, I was very hesitant to have people put money into it because I was buying guns for rebels. You gotta love her. You gotta love her. But then actually, in the end, that money, a lot of that, and the United Nations is a wonderful organization, don't get me wrong, but a lot of that money did get diverted. I don't know about for guns, but it did get diverted. So, oh my goodness. Okay. Saving the day. We can't go through life without a few bumps. And I had one. I had a girlfriend whose name shall not be named, for my wife, you know, like the Harry Potter, whatever that phrase is, for a few years, and it broke up very badly. And I was in Utah going to university, and my mother, I'd call once or twice a week, or a month, and she recognized that I was in, you know, I was really hurt and in trouble, and she came out immediately. She says, I'm coming on the next plane, I'm fine, I'm gonna call, make a reservation, I'll be there tomorrow. And she, you know, it was hard. I'm sure none of you have ever had any relationships that have gone bad, right? Never, never. And she came and picked me up, and that was a very special, and then again, that positive, bright light bulb picked me up. And then when I graduated, this is a little low, I'm not leaning because I'm tired, it's sort of like comfortable here, you know. But when I graduated from engineering school, mechanical engineering degree, it was the bottom, it was 1983, and you had interviewed, and people that had gotten jobs were coming back. People, you'd interview with people, and they say, we're here because we normally interview, but there are no jobs. And it was hard, because I had graduated, and I couldn't get a job with 98% of the people. And my mother sensed that, and she came out immediately, and we got the phone book. We went up, like, to the library to go research jobs. She says, this is here. We're going to lay it all out. This is what you're going to do. Is this okay? We'll do this, this, and this. And actually, one of the interviews I had actually turned out to be a job. They had, so I had gotten a job maybe a month or two after that, after all, which was extremely lucky because all my friends hadn't. And, you know, so, but my mother came out and did that. Let's see here. She was the best grandmother, the absolute best grandmother. I have four children and four grandchildren. My oldest son here, he's the only producer I have thus far. So do you want to stand up and take a bow, John? Where's John? And after four sons and then three grandsons, we finally got a granddaughter a month ago. So just a beautiful granddaughter. But she loved all of her grandchildren. She loved them and had an individual time. And when my oldest grandson, Elias, heard, he had come out for Henry's funeral, but also knew my grandmother from many visits. When he heard that she had passed, he cried. He really, really cried. And that's a special thing. And then well, I don't know how to end this, but I will. Yeah, my mother lived life grand. She really did. She was not perfect like everyone in this room, but she lived life grand. And, you know, we're all going to miss her, but we all have that influence of her. And she will be dearly missed. Yeah, the reality kind of hit. I mean, we were there for that kind of rough dying process. It was not slow. It was not slow, but when we came through the airport, normally I'd buy a See's chocolate box for her. And I looked at it and I go, no, I don't have to do that this time. But she will be missed. We love her. She's with my father. When we went to the internment today, all of a sudden, all this huge flock of geese flew over us. And then a second wave, a smaller wave, and I said, that's kind of a miracle, you know, because none of the geese flew after that. And then my father was saying, Helene, one flock of geese is enough. He says, no, I want a second smaller one, just so they know. So we had that second flock of geese fly over, but she is in a better place. We love her, and we will always think kindly of her, and thank you.
Thank you all for your wonderful memories. A reading from Lamentations 3:22-26. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Here ends the reading. And a reading from Romans 8. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Here ends the reading.
Helene Pande was, as we've heard, a wife, a mother, a grandmother, an aunt, a kind soul, a willing helper, and the life of the party. But most importantly, Helene is a child of God. And so though today is a difficult day for many of us, as we say goodbye to this incredible woman, we must begin by acknowledging this truth. Helene is a child of God, loved beyond measure, loved beyond death. The last months of Helene's life were certainly not the easiest or maybe the most joyous of her entire life. Her beloved husband, Henry, as we know, passed away back in May. And so Helene, a woman who loved being around other people, was probably a little bit more lonely than usual. She probably didn't let her sadness show, but I'm sure that deep down inside, she really missed having that cocktail hour with her husband every afternoon. Earlier this week, I had the opportunity to talk with Helene's daughters, and they both mentioned that it was difficult watching their once vibrant, joyous mother decline in her health over the past several months and also deal with the loss of her husband like this. It just didn't seem right. It didn't seem right that a woman so joyous and vibrant and positive should have to endure as she did those last months. But I also learned, as we heard, that Helene never tired of helping other people. She loved to give gifts. She loved to be a mother and a grandmother. She loved being a mother and a grandmother, even to people who weren't her children. Anyone who needed just a little bit of extra love in their life, that's what Helene was there for. And so as I thought about all of these details, a picture of this woman started to form in my head. I never had the opportunity to personally meet Helene, but if I was to summarize everything we just heard and everything I heard earlier this week, I think I would say that Helene was great at making people feel at home. People loved having her over for their parties because she brought so much energy and joy, and she impacted the lives of so many people because she listened and cared and put relationships above all else. She made people feel loved and comfortable and at home. And so when a joyous, kind, thoughtful, caring woman like this is taken from us, it can be very painful and very hard. But friends, Helene Pande is a child of God. She was claimed by God long ago, and so we know that though there was sadness and pain as her lifetime came to a close, our Christian faith declares that God has already restored Helene in the resurrection. She's not sad anymore. She's not hurting anymore. Once again, she's the life of the party. I want to share a story with all of you that I think will help explain all of these details a little better. You see, a little while back, my wife and I got to go through the thrilling process of house hunting. And so we downloaded the Zillow app on our phones, and then we would share every now and then when a house came along that looked like it fit our needs and our hopes and our dreams. And we got a realtor, and we looked at a bunch of properties, and we finally found one that seemed to fit. And my wife and I, we were really excited about this new house. Not just because it was fitting all the details on our checklist, but because of what it represented for us. This house was going to be our family home, the place where our kids would grow up. It was large enough so that our kids could continue to grow and still have the space they needed. And it was just so warm and friendly and welcoming. It was going to be perfect for birthdays and Thanksgivings and Christmases for years and years to come. And so we signed all the paperwork and did the inspections, and we bought our forever home. But guess what? We bought that house 2 years ago. And here's what I didn't tell you. It's in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. We thought this was our forever home, but we were wrong. God had other plans. Just last month, my family and I packed up that house, and we moved here to Denver, Colorado, because God was calling us to a new place. And so I'm telling you all this story because it just goes to show you that no earthly home is forever. No earthly home is forever. Even our physical bodies, these physical homes that we inhabit for our entire life, even they are temporary. As Helene knew all too well, even these bodies that we live in can break down, and people who were once vibrant and energetic and the life of the party can then become fragile and tired. But as I've been saying to you all along, Helene is a child of God. I did not say that she was a child of God. I said that she is a child of God. And that means that God has made promises to Helene. Though her time in this earthly home, her time in her earthly body, though that chapter has concluded, we know that Jesus has already restored and welcomed her to her heavenly home. God made a promise to Helene, just as God makes a promise to each and every one of us. It's a promise that says that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. We heard it read from the book of Romans just a few minutes ago. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor demons, nor things present, nor things to come, nor any powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Just because we're feeling sad and confused this day over the loss of this great woman, none of these emotions, none of these circumstances will separate us from the love of God. Death and sorrow and suffering and decay don't get to win. Jesus the Good Shepherd will never abandon us. No foe can separate us. Our earthly homes may not be forever, but because of the unending, undeniable love of God, we know that Jesus will lead us to our forever heavenly home. In the resurrection, God puts us all back together. I give you the good news today of letting you know that Helene isn't hurting anymore. She isn't sad anymore. She doesn't feel out of place or like she's lost a step. She's with her husband Henry now. And she's healed. And she's whole. And she's home. Thanks be to God for this victory over death that has been promised to us. And thanks be to God for Helene Pande, for her life here on earth, and for her new life in her forever heavenly home. Amen.
Be my ears, be the only voice.
Lord, my rock, lead me safely home. Every step that I make, be the road I will take, be the thoughts that I keep, and in every word I speak. Lord, my strength, Lord, my rock, lead me through the dark. Lord, my strength, Lord, my rock, heal this wounded heart. Lord, my strength, Lord, my rock, you and you alone. Lord, my strength, Lord, my rock, lead me safe.
Let us be in a spirit of prayer this afternoon. Let us pray. Almighty God, in holy baptism, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Give courage and faith to all who mourn, and a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. God of all grace, we give you thanks because by his death, our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection, he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I invite you to stand to sing Amazing Grace, number 779 in the hymnal.
Let us now commend our sister Helene to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Helene. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Receive now the day's blessing. As you go on your way, may God go with you. May God go before you to show you the way, above you to watch over, beside you to be your friend. May God be within you to give you peace, this day and always, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Just a reminder, you are all welcome and invited to join the family for a reception that will be held in the fellowship hall out of here and turn left. I hear that there might be martinis available, among other snacks and treats. So we do hope that you can stick around to celebrate Helene's life and continue sharing those stories and speaking her present. Let us now go forth in peace in the name of Christ. Amen.